Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are watching us from. Thank you very much for joining today. We are delighted to welcome you to NICE International Women's Summit 2020. NICE International Women's Summit 2020 is organized to bring together the dynamic women experts in the field of international relations from around the world, wherein they will share their ideas and expertise for better and meaningful future engagement. Our aim is also to reflect the fact that there are enough excellent women experts in the field of international relations, foreign policy, and security issues. This is the very first women summit organized by NICE in America. Throughout the summit, we'll be having 10 sessions that will take place at two Zoom simultaneously. We have around 71 experts and speakers from 12 countries, including Nepal, India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, the US, the UK, Russia, Armenia, the Philippines, Switzerland, and Indonesia. So this is the third session of the summit, and to moderate the session, it's a real pleasure to have Dr. Swasti Rao. Dr. Swasti Rao is a professor at the Department of Security and Strategy Studies, Aligarh Muslim University. She has a PhD in Advanced International Politics from Tsukuba University, Japan. She's also a recipient of the Okita Memorial Scholarship in 2010 from ICCR, Indian Council of Foreign Cultural Relations. So without any further ado, I'd like to welcome Dr. Swasti Rao to moderate the session.
Thank you so much, and it is indeed a pleasure to welcome all you young participants to the session. And the third session is on South Asia. And without further ado, I think I should call on the first participant to start presenting. The first participant is Ambika Vishwanath. So Ambika, if you're there, please be ready. Just a few things that please try to wrap up within 10 minutes, and then we can take up questions later. All right. So Ambika is going to be presenting on rethinking transboundary water governance in South Asia, which is a very, very important and a relevant topic which connects, South Asia as a whole. So looking forward to seeing you present, Ambika. Good luck.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Rao. And thank you, Nepal Institute for International Cooperation and Engagement, for putting this together, especially since nowadays I feel like we see more MANILs happening than ever before. So this is really important. I've got a big clock, so I'm going to try and keep it in my 10 minutes, but feel free to cut me off if you need to. So I'm going to pick up on the theme of cooperation and engagement, which is also an institute's tagline, and talk about that in the context of transboundary water cooperation. So when I say South Asia in this context, I just want to make it clear that I'm talking about South Asian countries that share land borders, looking at it from an Indian perspective. So obviously in this case, I'm not going to refer to Sri Lanka or the Maldives, but really I'm talking about Pakistan, India, China, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, and Myanmar. This whole region is also popularly known as the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, which includes Afghanistan, but I want to touch on Afghanistan for the moment. Now, if we think about this whole region, west to east, we share two incredibly large river systems. This is the Indus on the western side and the Brahmaputra Meghnad Basin on the eastern side. This whole region as a block is home to almost 12% of the world's population. So that's a very large number right there. There are hundreds and hundreds of rivers that are shared across the region. And interestingly, which I think a lot of people don't think about, is that despite us sharing all of these hundreds of rivers, there are less than 30 treaties, agreements, and MOUs between the countries of this region. So that's a very small number comparatively when we think of the number of rivers that we're sharing and the large river systems that are in play over here. All of these treaties and MOUs and agreements are all bilateral in nature. They're not multilateral at all, which is again a very important point to put out there, because if we look at other regions around the world, there are the having multilateral institutions share and govern your water resources are much more common. So this region is also one of the most vulnerable regions. There are several reports, including the UN report that came out in 2016, that talks about how we're one of the most vulnerable hotspots and regions across the the world. And this is not only because of increasing population or demand, which is very important, or human development, but two very important factors. And one is climate change, and the other is hydropolitical tensions. And that's where I'd like to focus a little bit, is that water very often then becomes a tool when you talk about... Sorry, I don't know if somebody was saying something, but I'm just going to continue. So water becomes a very important tool then when we talk about and think about hydropolitical tensions in this region. They're used to exert power or influence, and very often then they become part of another larger problem. So it's very, very important that we put into place measures that not only safeguard our shared resources, in this case, water, you know, so the rivers and the lakes and the glaciers, from these hydropolitical tensions, but also from climate change, which is no longer something that we can consider as a looming, you know, threat that's there in the future, but it's here. It's very much something that we face every day. So it's very important, and this is where I stress on how we need to rethink, one, how do we look at this region when it comes to our interconnected water systems? And how do we rethink our governance for the future, right? These shared waters, for very long, we've always considered them as a supply. How do we use them? How do we abuse them? How do we use them to advance development? How do we use them to advance human development for energy sources and everything? But we rarely think of how they're very part of how they're much a part of everything else in our lives, right? So energy development, agriculture, irrigation, and then foreign policy. So the minute we start to think about it from that perspective, we then realize that the water here that we're sharing is not only a supply issue, but it's very much a part of everything else when we come to governance and policy making. And I think that is a very fundamental rethinking that needs to happen when it comes to this region. And this cannot be done in, you know, isolation. We can't do it at a sub-regional level or a community level or a country level. It needs to be done at a regional level. Clearly, this is a lot easier said than done, because if it was possible, we would have already been there in the South Asian region. Many other countries around the world have already embarked on this path, and they've had some measures of success that I feel like we could always study. But I feel there's two things I'd like to propose in how we might be able to reach this engagement, right? Taking again from my theme of engagement and cooperation. Engagement between think tanks, academics, and the scientific community. This really needs to increase tenfold, and it needs to increase starting yesterday. This region is very popularly known, and the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, as a black hole of data. There is very, very little data, and whatever little data that is available is very closely guarded between in the countries themselves. There's very little sharing. There is some amount, a number of sharing, you know, there are some MOUs, there's one between India and China, India and some of our other neighbors, but there's nothing happening on a transboundary level, nothing happening on a regional level. And this really needs to change. And I think the think tank, academic and scientific community can really play a huge role in changing how we, one, access data, how we create data, and how we share data. This will then lead us to, you know, a few more steps in the direction of being able to create systems or an ecosystem where we are on the same footing, because data then becomes knowledge, and that knowledge is very powerful. The other way that I feel like this needs to, we can move in a much more positive direction is creation of a multilateral mechanism where we collectively manage and cooperate over our shared water resources. It's a wonderful concept, but it's something that's a little bit far away. What we can do to get there, along with step one, is to use our existing multilateral institutions. Now, South Asia is not known for very robust institutions in that regard. I mean, SAARC or BIMSTEC or BBINR, they're there, but they're not very, very good. There's a lot of negatives in these institutions, but the fact that they have been created, that the fact that they exist, the fact that dialogue does happen is positive. And I feel like we need to use that as a stepping stone to make something more happen. There's also a lot of conversation happening on railway lines across the borders, highways, inland navigation, and all of these then make your little box blocks that come together to create what could in the future be better and more conversation on our transboundary water systems. So I end with just the one thought, right? There are these two very important tracks that we can do. They're not overly contentious. They don't create too much tension in capitals across the region. And they can be done in small methods, spaces where then they come together to build this ideal block for the future. I think if we can create these ecosystems where at the very basis of it, we're rethinking how we consider and how we look at our shared system, water systems, our shared transboundary waters, not simply as a resource, but as a part and parcel of everything else in our governance, then the potential for having something positive in the future is very, very high. I'll leave it with that. And questions, of course, when we're done at the end. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Rao. I think I stuck to my 10 minutes of time. No?
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ambika. I have to say that you have.
Oh, okay. No,
we can always catch up for the question answer session.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. It was indeed a very interesting, presentation and a very need. It's a need of the hour as well, so that we realize our shared resources and the responsibility and, that comes along with it. Right. Thank you so much, Ambika.
Thank you.
Going ahead, the second presentation for today is from Ms. Babita Sharma, and she is going to be talking on the dowry system and its impact in the society and target to South Asia countries. So she's going to be talking about the dowry system problem. And I think it is a very, very relevant topic, and a lot of us here would be interested in knowing what she has to present. So over to you, Babita. Looking forward to a great presentation.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rao. Good morning, good afternoon to all of you. Today I'm going to present, Dr. Rao already said about my topic, but I will focus this topic on India and Nepal. So dowry system is being a very big problem in the society, mainly. It is affecting to women, many women being victims by this cause. Obviously, it has been seen on negatively in the society. Presenting on negative way in the society, but its theme, its thought was not that its value, it was not that that was practiced in ancient times. Actually, the thought of parents for the daughters was good. In the ancient time, dowry was a love gift for their daughters, believing that that can maintain their independent after marriage, and which is believing by many scholars. But later on, the value of being changed, comes through the society carry on negatively. They themselves made it their according to their interest. So it seems very bad in our society. It seems like greed, which is rooted in the society, mainly in India and Parai region of Nepal. Even the family are very rich and good position. So, I this type of practice making huge problem, huge burden to the parents, for my father and mother. So that they don't want to conceive like baby. They already want to mentally they already want to avoid to give birth and cook it, to give birth a daughter. So it is mostly affected. Yeah, obviously it is affecting to all the societies, but it is mostly affected in vulnerable community in the society. Many cases we have in Nepal and India, but I want to say one case that held in Nepal in 2019. A reputed doctor, he make his wife on death stage. That was
yes, Babita, are you facing any trouble? Hello, Babita, is she audible to the rest of our participants?
Hello.
Yes, Babita, are you there?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
So it seems a big problem. And that all of we know and are seeing the trend in the society. So it should be stopped. It should be the dirty and the criminal activities which is raging in the society, that should be stopped, raising the voice from all of our side. So every daughter's parents have to be aware to reform such activities. No one can do for us. That is, so every individual's minds has a different interest. They are bargaining a daughter to exchange it with cash. So it should be stopped as soon as possible. Obviously, these days in urban areas, women are more aware than themselves. They focus on their career and capacity. Capacity enhancement, but that is not seems sufficient. So dowry system demanding criminal activities in the society, and which is suppressing human rights of women as well. So it is all of the problems of patriarchal thought. It all things driven from the patriarchal thought. So mostly societies of South Asian countries. Driven by patriarchal thought, so we have to raise our voice for curbing dowry system, simultaneously lobby for the equality between male and female for every entitlements. So it is so. Hello.
Oh yes, please go ahead.
Hello. Yeah.
Yes, Babita, sorry, please go ahead. Yes.
Sorry for the disturbance. So at last, we have to be aware on this issue, which seems on the shadow. Government is not taking this issue on seriously. So from our individual side or society side, we have to always we have to advocacy for the reform reform means not only in practice for the thought and to change in our mentality, to change in our activities. So it can be done by society, one society and family, then it can be eradicated properly. So parents prefer setting money aside for the dowry system than investing a girl's education. So we should, we always have to raise our voice to educate women or girls, and then giving a money or any property as a dowry. Thank you so much. Sorry for the disturbance from my side.
Thank you so much, Babita, for your presentation on a very relevant topic, I must say. We would be very glad to have other people ask you questions about the real problems in trying to tackle the menace of dowry. With this, we come to the third presentation of our session today, which is going to be done by Swati Prabhu. And Swati Prabhu is going to be talking about climate change mitigation and the role of sub-regional, sub-national agencies in mitigating, the negative impact of climate change. Again, this is something which is extremely relevant. It is something which is the need of the hour. And Swati, we are all eager to listen to what you are going to be talking about. So over to you, Swati. Good luck.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank NIIT for giving me this opportunity to present today. And it makes it even more special since it's a Women's Summit. So I'll quickly start off with this topic of climate change mitigation. You know, why is it relevant to discuss it today and why am I talking about it now? And my co-presenter Ambika mentioned in her presentation that it has been observed over the years that climate change is happening right now. It's a reality. It's no longer a farce. And developing economies are some of the worst sufferers of environmental degradation. So this entire debate or the narrative of climate policy making becomes even more important, becomes essential. And it has recently occupied the focus or the locus of current environmental global affairs. And it's also because of the rising carbon emissions. So talking of South Asia, I come to the this region of the Indian subcontinent countries in this region have borne the brunt of rising global temperatures, which can be attributed to the disproportionate measures or disproportionate levels of equity and growth or development, or the lack of it rather. Also, in the recent past, I would like to borrow the words of Catherine Michalova. You know, she has very aptly mentioned that India, particularly India, has transitioned from this position of a protest voice on the fringes of global environmental policy to occupying the focus or to occupying this pivotal position, thereby actively shaping this entire narrative of global environmental effort. It's making effort towards mitigating climate change. I'm not talking about the results here, but I'm just talking about the effort that India has been making in the recent past. And here, it is important to highlight how Prime Minister Modi, a few years back, when he came back in his second term, clearly mentioned that climate change is one of the biggest challenges that not only India, but the whole world is facing, next to terrorism. New Delhi needs to come out, and he quoted this, and then I quote, that New Delhi needs to come out of its traditional naysayer approach to become this dynamic broker by shedding old mindsets when we talk about climate change negotiations, whether it's the UNFCCC or the COP, or the various COP sessions that has happened over the years. So in certain terms, we can say that, we can observe that India has come a long way by putting forth a strong fight at the negotiation tables, by fighting against the developed economies and, putting forth its promise of cutting down on emissions and also encouraging the growth of renewable energy and solar power. Here, I can give you the example of the International Solar Alliance that India signed with France in 2015. And India also has set this target of increasing or pushing for solar energy
achieving 100 gigawatt of power by the year 2022. So now the argument here that I'm making today in my presentation is this historical responsibility of carbon emissions. It does not just lie on India, but also on countries like USA, European Union, and China. Why I say this? This is based on a report by Climate Analytics, which conducted a study of emissions for the period between 1850 to 2012. And it was observed that the responsibility, this historical responsibility of taking care of emissions, in fact, the top three emitters were USA, which emitted about 20% of the entire lot. Then comes the European Union, 17%, and then comes China, about 12%. And they cumulatively, it was predicted in the report, that they will contribute to about 50% of the global mean temperature of 21. So in this context, in this report, if we go through the report, it has been mentioned that India's emissions come up to about approximately 5%. Now, this was the story of the past. Coming to the present scenario, we see that India now is the world's third largest emitter. And it hence occupies, again, a very important position when we talk about climate change mitigation. So we can see this dual role that India can play. One is it does not have this historical responsibility of the past per se, if we talk about theoretically. But when we see practically, that is the present scenario, India has been contributing immensely towards GHG emissions. So this duplexity or this dual role that India has, it provides India with this unique responsibility when we talk about climate change mitigation. And since India is positioned in this important region of South Asia, you know, geopolitically it's an important region, India can inspire us, India can help its neighbors in curbing its emissions. And here I can give an example of development partnership, which is, I'm not using the word aid here, I'm talking about developing partnerships or developing cooperation between India and its neighboring countries, for example, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, where it is investing money or where it is providing assistance or facilities when it comes to environment or when it comes to climate change mitigation. I'll quickly go over. I think I'm done with my 5 minutes. Now here, when I talk about development partnership, it is important to mention the co-benefits approach. So co-benefits approach implies a domestic climate policy formulation, whereby a conscious effort, an effort is made to mitigate and adapt, as well as having goals, having realistic, pragmatic development goals, which talks about equity and which can also be extended to the neighboring countries, not just for India, but also for its neighboring countries in the region. Now I'll quickly jump to the debate of sustainable development goals. Climate change mitigation is incomplete without discussing sustainable development goals. Stock taking of sustainable development goals might seem a very, difficult task, a tedious process, an uphill task. 5 years have passed by since sustainable development goals were formulated, and we stand in the year 2020, and we see that not much progress has been made, unfortunately. And surprisingly, it is not that difficult to take, to do stock taking of sustainable development goals. To use the quote of Farhana Yami, she noted in one of her papers that India, in fact, humanity is now faced with three options, either to die, to survive, or to thrive. It's up to humanity to, take up this chance of either to thrive or to die or to survive. So in this scenario, I bring in the role of subnational agencies. How subnational agencies can play an important role as far as environmental protection or achieving sustainable goals are concerned. So I come from a European studies background. So I looked up, I was reading this EU policy report on sustainable development goals implementation. And the report is ironically titled Reflection. So it's still reflecting, as far as sustainable implementation of sustainable development goals are concerned, or how subnational agencies can be included in this entire goal, in this entire game plan of achieving SDGs by the year 2030. That's the target that UN has put. So, basically a lot has been said, but very less has been done so far. And I quickly will pick up some examples from certain agencies who've been actively participating participating in environmental protection, and it has been termed in various newspaper reports and research articles a kind of a civil disobedience when we talk about environmental protection. So there's this shift, you know, in climate change mitigation from only policy reports to this mass civil disobedience. And surprisingly, it does not come from NGOs or from business enterprises. It comes from common citizens like you and me sitting here on Zoom meetings, you know. So they do all these meetings, they would do all these protest things online, on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, everywhere. And I'll quickly give you two examples of such meetings, of such protests. So one, I'll take the example from Western Europe and Britain. For example, this agency or this group, which took about a week-long mass blockade in major cities to register their concerns for the planet. It was called the Extinction Rebellion. And they believe that civil disobedience is brought out vociferously, in their actions by drawing inspiration, for example, from the Indian freedom struggle of 1947, or you can name the US civil rights movement. And this Extinction Rebellion, that is XR, it's abbreviated as XR, has a branch here in India as well, which is called XR India. And it was one of the reports I was reading online. It was formed out of pure activism by a Delhi-based environmental campaigner. And opposed, when we, you know, pit this agency against the traditional NGOs, these groups are majorly people's movements. You know, these are just common citizens who have come together to register their anger against the rising emissions or what problems they are facing when we talk about lack of access to resources. And the main aim is to avert climatic breakdown and also to minimize the risk of human extinction. You know, again, to die, to survive, or to thrive. And another example is for EAP, another entity which mobilizes young people like me, or, you know, who have joined us here today, towards bringing an ecological revolution. So when we talk about the subnational agencies, the Indian government has, you know, displayed its endeavor towards localizing the sustainable development goals. And they have this, I was reading up this report of NITI Aayog, which talks about the whole of government approach, which includes the subnational governments as well, the state governments, and also the subnational agencies. And even though these movements are still at a very nascent stage, it is too early to say whether they are successful or not, these mass movements definitely carry the potential of, you know, aiding or supplementing the government protocols of environmental protection in the years to come. And the government has not officially spoken about these movements on paper or press reports or press releases, but I don't think they are complaining in any way. So we wrap by, you know, stating the fact that the global community today, you know, we all know that it stands at the crossroads of balancing between climate change mitigation and human security, the largest debate about human security. And India definitely can play a big, big role when we talk about climate change mitigation in the subcontinent. And it still has a long way to go. And I feel it can do much better when it involves common people like you and me.
That's right. Okay.
Thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful presentation, Swati. And I think you have a way to go, because it is something, it is, as I said, the need of the hour. And with this, we come to the fourth presentation of the day, which is being done by Sindhu. Welcome, Sindhu. Sindhu is a research scholar, and she's been working on asymmetric conflict in South Asia. I think asymmetric conflict is another area where, you know, South Asia is really marked by a lot of tension and a lot of unrest. And we look forward to Sindhu's presentation, and I hope she sheds some light on the nature and supposed solutions to the asymmetric conflict in South Asia. Good luck, Sindhu.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, you are. You are completely audible to me. Yes.
I had shared a presentation. I'm waiting for them to put it on the screen.
Okay, you have a PowerPoint? All right. Yes, I'll just convey it to the... Yes. Yeah.
So yes, good afternoon to everybody present here at the session. Many greetings to everybody. I'll be presenting my research paper on asymmetric conflicts in South Asia. The format of my presentation, go to the next slide, please. The format of my pre- presentation is I'll be covering what the theme is and the significance of the study, my objectives, methodology, data sources, the analysis, interpretation, and the research findings. The next slide, please. So what is asymmetry? Asymmetry is a coin that is a term that was coined by the American defense establishment, and it can be defined as the willingness or the ability of an inferior or a weaker adversary to apply all of its strength available against a superior adversary, and it does so to achieve some strategic ends. And it seeks to cause massive psychological, political, physical, as well as economic damage. And what it seeks to do is to challenge the legitimacy of state actors. And asymmetric warfare and conflicts include irregular warfare, low intensity conflicts, insurgency, and terrorism, amongst many other things. Several regions in the world today are either or both perpetrators as well as victims of asymmetric conflicts, and I shall be dealing with South Asia and asymmetric conflict. The next slide, please. The theme becomes significant because in the 21st century, we've seen emergence of various non-state actors, and there is an increase in violence which threatens the international security environment. And in South Asia, the region has come under a lot of scrutiny because it has two nuclear weapon states and due to the instability and tensions between some neighboring nations. And India, as a major leading power in the region, has often been a victim of several forms of asymmetric conflict and other low-intensity conflicts, especially from its northwestern front. And in the research, I've tried to understand the issues that arise from asymmetric conflict in South Asia, and I've tried to explore some prospects for stability and peace in the region. Next slide, please. My objectives are to understand the concept of asymmetric conflicts in the 21st century and to look at some trends in the South Asian region, to examine India's vulnerability to this conflict, as well as later on to look at the challenges that this poses to the stability of the region and some steps that have been taken so far to address the issue. The next slide, please. This is the methodology that I have followed, mostly a qualitative method, descriptive analytical research. And I have used deductive approach with content analysis. The next slide, please. My sources are from government websites and other secondary sources, articles and reports that are available. The next slide, please. So asymmetric conflict as a term has been on the discourse of security and strategy for, it has gained more momentum over the recent few decades, but however, as a phenomenon and as a practice, it's been existing for a long time, perhaps since the history of nation states itself. And although the phenomenon is not new, what is new is the rise of non-state actors against state, which seek to legitimize violence. And some aspects like technology, innovation, and globalization have been level players between state actors and non-state actors. And when it comes to the nature of asymmetric conflict, some elements have remained unaltered, such as their irregularity, their unexpected initiation, the disparity of their targets, and the use of conventional means. But however, some new elements, such as the sophisticated technology, the planned way of planning and execution of these activities, as well as the sole intent to cause anarchy, it pretty much thrives on that objective itself. And the forms of asymmetric conflicts encompasses a variety of them these days. Low intensity conflicts, the effort to maintain conflict below the subconventional level of warfare, and other terrorism issues, which include lone wolf terrorism and lot of other forms of insurgency and so on. They are, although these forms seem very interrelated to each other, there are some very distinct characteristics which differentiate them, such as the nature, their objectives, the impact that they have, how they sustain, or the targets that they have. So there are some distinct attributes to all of these. And there are also some new actors which have started to ascribe to it, be it some state-sponsored terrorism activities as well or other new forms which have come up. And moving on to the origin of asymmetric conflict in South Asia, it has its provenance in the region's historical past. One example could be the establishment of Mauryan Empire with, against a much more powerful Nanda dynasty, which was defeated, and other such examples. And all of the South Asian countries have encountered asymmetric conflict in different forms in varying different time frames and intensities, which I shall be covering in a little while. But most of the asymmetric conflicts in South Asia, what they're experiencing, the causes of these has usually been a consequence of their own domestic issues or the lack of effective governance and other politicization of issues. The region has been a perpetual victim of terrorism, one of the major incidents being the Easter Sunday attacks in Sri Lanka last year. And South Asia has also seen the emergence of new asymmetric tactics, such as the suicide bombings by the LTTE of Sri Lanka. The next slide, please. Trends of asymmetric conflict in South Asia. The non-military asymmetric threats to South Asia have become increasingly high. And some of these trends include low-intensity conflicts, that mostly this has been between India and Pakistan, an example being the Kargil conflict of 1999. And other varying trespassing of the line of control and so many other attacks like that across the boundaries. Terrorism, another one which I covered about Sri Lanka and other more several, not just, some of them have also been state-sponsored and different incidences like that. Even this is terrorism, it has happened in all of the countries in South Asia. None of them have been exempted from bomb blast or any other such issues. Insurgency is yet another one, be it in India with the left-wing extremism or Maoist insurgency elements in Nepal or the Baluch insurgency movement in Pakistan. Religious extremism has been yet another threat to the region. Some of them have also been coming up in the region, in the country of Maldives. Guerrilla warfare is a tactic that is adopted by asymmetric actors. And suicide bombings, which I covered. And another trend has been the assassination of personalities and attack on non-combat, on civilians. Assassination of personalities, an example being that of Rajiv Gandhi in 1991. And also another trend is the accusation of state involvement in these asymmetric attacks. The next slide, please. India's vulnerability to asymmetric conflict, which we covered growing terrorist attacks, the one of the most major ones being our Mumbai attacks and the rise in low intensity conflicts, which I also covered. The issues of insurgency, left-wing extremism, where they resort to guerrilla warfare tactics. Usually they have a physical sanctuary from where they launch the attacks and go back to that. And which all of these have definitely threatened the security scenario of India. And also India is located perhaps in a slightly hostile neighborhood environment. It faces threats from several of its neighboring countries. And some of these insurgency groups have formed sanctuaries in the neighboring countries like Bangladesh and Myanmar and other such issues which India faces. And contemporary challenges of asymmetric conflict to South Asian region stability. Pakistan has also in fact been a victim of several terrorist attacks, some of it being launched on its own civilians and attack on officials. In fact, according to the government of Pakistan website, it has proscribed 71 terrorist organizations according to its according to official data released by it. And Afghanistan, we are aware of the situation with Taliban and several lives lost, which I should be showing, I should be having the data soon shown. And in Nepal too, the incidences of bombing by the JNMM and so many others, including, and even in Bhutan has also not been exempted from this form of attack. For instance, in 2008, the bomb blasts that were conducted by the URFP because they were unhappy with the democratic transition that was happening in Bhutan. And all of these countries as well, remaining ones. So another unique feature of asymmetric conflict in South Asia has been that states have often themselves engaged in denying that the menace exists at all. For example, the insurgency groups that were located in Bangladesh and India kept repeatedly asking for action to be taken against them, but the regime under Khalid Zia kept denying that such groups did not exist in Bangladesh or they were not harboring them. So and of course these happened due to some political compulsions, and that has obviously increased the threat scenario, and it has impacted the effectiveness to deal with the issue itself. And there are some steps that have been taken to deal with this, such as first comes the individual government actions, like India has trained special commandos to deal with left-wing extremism, and between two governments, a lot of confidence building measures that have come up, and also a training of neighboring forces. That is one part of the actions that have been taken so far. And to address domestic reasons, Bangladesh, once the attack happened, it took years to resolve the conflict and to really deal with the issue. And after 2008, there have been no bomb blast attacks in Bhutan. So some effective measures which have been taken like that. And Maldives established the National Counter-Terrorism Center to deal with...
That's great. Yeah. Please wrap up. Please wrap up, Chandra. Yes.
Another has been the help from international organizations such as the UN peacekeeping forces. The next, this is a data showing the yearly fatalities in South Asia, and according to the country wise, the major most affected has been Afghanistan. Next slide, please. Research findings are, of course, that technology globalization have been level players between state and non-state actors. And there have been several forms experienced by each of the South Asian countries at different time frames and in varying intensities.
That's quite interesting. We can always take up questions with you because you're running out of time. So, could you please just conclude in 10 seconds if you can, and then we can just wrap it up. Do you want to do that, or you want to take up questions directly?
Of course, we may not be able to obliterate asymmetric conflicts, but definitely mitigating them is the need of that. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you so much for your very wonderful presentation, Sindhu. And with this, I think this is a topic that a lot of viewers would be interested in knowing more. And with this, we come to the fifth presentation of our session, which is going to be a presentation by Ms. Karnika Jain, and she is also a doctoral candidate at GNU, and she is going to be talking about how to understand youth radicalism in South Asia. So that itself sounding very interesting, and I'm sure it is going to cut across a lot of disciplines. So over to you, Karnika.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. I would like to extend my thanks to Bhis for organizing this webinar. I would request the host to start the slide.
Karnika, you can start. We are uploading it.
I can't see this.
Karnika, could you please start with your presentation? They are uploading the slides, so you could start, introduce yourself. Yes, and you can start with what you're going to be presenting on.
The topic of my presentation is understanding the youth radicalization in South Asia. Next slide. It is an often terrorism and radicalization is an oft-discussed critical problem for the world. And as we know that radicalization and terrorism is spreading across the region, it is posing a graver threat in the international realm. Can you please move us to the next slide? With the origin of transboundary radicalization, the problem has become graver. It cut across the boundaries and it has become a new reality. Radicalization and terrorism is one of the gravest threats pertaining to human life, peace, security, and development. Talking in particular about South Asia, radicalization and terrorism has been studied extensively for a long time, but still the region is confronting the blight of the problem. South Asian countries, ever since they got independent, have been facing multitude of challenges. And one of the challenges is the rapid growth of radical tendencies combined with terrorist violence. Unfortunately, as per the report of Global Terrorism Index 2019, South Asia was recorded as the world's most affected region by terrorism. Next slide. Why youth has been targeted? As we know that the worldwide, the youth has been at the target point of the radical and terrorist organizations for training and recruitment and for any other purposes, and South Asia is no exception dealing with this threat. This trend is further strengthened by the UN Secretary General's statement in 2019, which stated that violent extremist groups target and invest in young people because they are aware of their potential and their strong desire for change. What makes the South Asian region more vulnerable is that around half of its population is below the age of 25 years. This makes a potential fertile ground for mushrooming of youth bulge theory, which states that populated youth who are unemployed are generally gullible and are easy fall prey to the trap of radicalization. Next slide. There are different push factors which targets youth, and I'll be dealing with some of them. Secular privations have always been a major problem in the region for youth to get attracted to radical organizations. And one of them is the poor education system that creates disenchantment amongst the youth. Despite being education so important for the well-being of the society, for the development of the society, the regional spending on education, total GDP was 2.1%, which is gradually declining year on year as per the World Bank report. As per the another report, there are 95 million children school-going age who have not been enrolled in the formal education system. All these lack of accessibility and limitation of quality education creates conducive environment for terrorists to exploit the youth to expand their network in the region. Next slide. Unemployment is another issue which the South Asia is dealing with. There's been seen that there is a low conversion rate of youth from the education to the alley of employment, which is marked as the biggest hurdle of the youth getting employment. As per the UNICEF report 2019, 54% of the youth conclude schooling with no schools of fetching decent job of earning or fetching jobs. There's sluggish economy, low wages, vulnerable job sector, income disparities, and prolonged unemployment, which creates breeding ground for terrorists to expand their network. This is a report by World Bank which confirms that unemployed youth dropouts are more vulnerable and to violence and criminal activity who vent out their frustration and unrest on the society. Next slide. If we look at the aspect of radicalization, it has diverse ways from which it can radicalize people. It is extremely multifaceted. Recent terror attacks in South Asia reflects that irrespective of socioeconomic background, youth of any type is getting radicalized. Irrespective of their education, irrespective of their well-to-do belongings, well-off, there is seen as shifting economic profiles of new targets, which is making the region additionally vulnerable to the radicalization process. One of the major reasons for these kind of for this shifting economic profile could be counted as the influx of fundamentalist religious ideologies, which is seeding animosity amongst each other. There is continuous propaganda machinery. There is continuous brain hijacking of youth who have malleable view about the society and religion, which makes favorable ground and safe haven for terrorist groups to amplify their network in the region. South Asia being a complex, multi-religious, multi-ethnic society, but still communal and religious ideologies have a very powerful role in fracturing the societal cohesion. Next slide. Another reason which is seen for displaying the interest of terrorist groups in youth is their online presence. They are tech savvy. They are present on social media. As we know that world has become a global village, the penetration of internet has played a massive role in accessing and hijacking these young minds. Unfortunately, the region is home to 803 million internet users, making it the second largest in the world. All these groups proliferate these influences through social media to reap benefits of this value. Next slide. South Asia for a long time, ever since the countries got independent, have been facing problems like long-sustained poverty, destabilized economy, social insecurity, which sow the seeds of disengagement and unrest amongst the youth. Another reason is that it is one-fourth of the world's population, with 1.9 billion people. It puts extra pressure and implication for societal conflict. Worldwide, the region recorded the second lowest youth development after sub-Saharan Africa. Youth development indicators included education, employment, health well-being, and political participation. South Asian governments have been involved in counter-terror operations for a long time, but radicalization, they need to understand that it is an ideological threat, and it has to be handled with counter-ideology and counter-narrative measures. Next slide. So what are the solutions which could be undertaken by the region? It is highly critical for the states of South Asia to revisit their response mechanism vis-a-vis the threat of radicalization. They need to put a lot of efforts on the youth because they have enormous energy and potential. If channelized constructively, the dynamism that youth brings to the table could become a contributing factor to the socio-economic progress of the country in the South Asia. Second, there is a need of more public awareness programs, more community engagement programs, so that it could be ensured that youth are on the right track of development. Third, ideational and ideological responses is a need of an hour. Education structures need to collaborate. Collaboration can fashion a comprehensive South Asian response mechanism. And civil society plays a very important role because it could always detect new trends of radicalization at an early stage. It is a bridge between state and people, so it needs to be engaged more accessibly. Next slide. Another very important area which needs to be pondered upon is online radicalization leading to terrorism. Here, countering terror policies, speeches, and positive responses need to be strongly produced and circulated through the same channel of social media. Extremist groups have very robust networks. It is important us to remember, South Asia as a region, it is important us to remember that they have a robust network, and we also need to circulate these counter speeches through the same channel of social media. The region lacks the common platform where they could discuss the problem of radicalization, and in turn, the strategies to thwart the attack. The region faces the cross-border terrorism, but despite this, there is lack of collaborative mechanism, there is mistrust among the governments, and there is lack of information sharing which prevails. Therefore, concluding, I could say that the threat of radicalization and terrorism is real, and to evade this threat, it is very important for the region and prerequisite to ensure collective continuous measures along with state, civil society, governments, think tanks, academic institutions come together to fight this threat. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Karnika, for a very elaborate presentation on the problem of youth radicalization in South Asia. I'm sure you will get a lot of questions from the audience regarding it. With this, we come to the next presentation of our session, which is going to be done by Purnima. Welcome, Purnima. She is a research scholar, and she is going to be talking about yet another aspect of terrorism, which is the lone wolf phenomena, which means that particularly in simple terms, it means that when this one person becomes the terrorist. So with this, I welcome Purnima, and she's going to be presenting on how to understand the phenomena of lone wolf terrorism and the implications that it has for South Asia. And she is going to be reflecting, it is interesting because she's going to be comparing it with the case of Israel. Over to you, Purnima. Thank you.
Before starting, is there a possibility where I can operate the slides? I would like to efficiently use the time.
Right. I think for that, I think the NICE team will get back to you. She has a question.
I can share it from my laptop if it's not a problem.
Okay. Is that resolved? Hello, are you there, Ashita? I think Purnima needs a little bit of a guidance. Purnima, meanwhile, you can always start introducing, you know, your topic, and so that the flow is not really disturbed. So you can start talking about it.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Okay. So meanwhile, I'm sending.
Yeah.
Hello.
Is my presentation
visible?
Yes, it is visible. Yes, please okay. Go ahead.
Yes. So today I'm going to talk about loner terrorism and its implications for South Asia, especially for taking consideration of three countries, India, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka, through the case of Israel. So synopsis, as we've known, the paper has looked into lone wolf terrorism as an increasingly prevalent form of terrorism with its own attributes, nature, and characteristics, which we'll be seeing further. And we've taken Israel as one of those countries that is encountering this menace of lone wolf terrorism. And as we seem to effectively combat loan of terrorism, Israel has brought up a lot of counter-terrorism strategies which have been comparatively successful, and we're going to see what are the implications of loan of terrorism in South Asia and whether such strategies will be applicable in South Asia. So why this theme? We cannot deny that the problem of terrorism is to be taken easily, and it definitely disturbs the global peace and stability. And as we've seen with the emergence of new modes of terrorism, the issue has become much more precarious. Israel has been one of the countries which has through the years formed a comprehensive counterterrorism strategy, and there is also a need for South Asian states facing this issue to develop their own counterterrorism strategy suitable to their geopolitical environment. So who is a lone wolf? A person who acts on his or her own without orders from or even connections to an organization. Lone wolves generally operate individually, and they do not belong to an organized terrorist group. And also the modus operandi they use are framed by themselves without any direct instructions from any command or hierarchy, as seen in organized terrorist organizations. So what are the basic characteristics of lone wolf terrorism? They're likely to create their own ideology, which incidentally superimposes with the broader political and religious dispositions. And there are a lot of personal and political factors that combine and reinforce the motivation for these terrorists. And they can also drastically distort the functions of the society with just smaller attacks, causing widespread psychological disturbances to the population. And since with the progress in internet technology, bomb making and associated strategies have become easy to access without any authorization. So technology has been quite an enabler for lone wolf terrorists these days.
And showcasing of intent via statements, threats, letters, and even video proclamations are one major characteristics to look for. And especially since they don't have organizational affiliation, it's a challenge to nab and squash these attacks waged by lone wolf terrorists. So the element of surprise is especially more when it comes to this form of terrorism. Quickly going through the evolution of lone wolf terrorism, it is not something that is of the 21st century. We can trace it back to the 19th century among the anarchists, where they encouraged individuals to wage attack against the members of the bourgeois class by the propaganda by deed. And then anti-government sentiments and also leaderless resistance and white supremacy took over in the 20th century. Where interestingly, the term lone wolf was made more popular by white supremacists. And in 21st century, it has been taking the form of religious ideologies, and especially accelerated by technology and media and internet, various terrorist organizations could easily encourage vulnerable individuals around the world to wage their individual attacks. So what are the root causes? Majorly dividing them into individual dispositions and socio-political cultural circumstances. Psychological orientation is a major one. These lone wolves are likely to suffer from psychological disturbances, depression, anxiety attacks, but that does not mean that they lose touch with the reality or their cognition is disorganized. They tend to be socially isolated and they grow a liking towards acting alone. So also unpleasant childhood experiences, physical or mental abuse can also lead to such identity crisis, leading to such radical thoughts. And also personal beliefs, strong beliefs about against a particular race, community, religion, or even a sexual orientation can lead individuals to engage in such kind of activities. Going on to socio-political cultural circumstances, dissatisfaction about specific policies can lead to this is just a way of expression, expressing their dissatisfaction against specific policies. This is the prevailing xenophobic sentiments against anti-Zionist or even anti-Islamic and anti-Semitist feelings are expressed through lone wolf activities, lone wolf terrorism. Even social circle, being surrounded by family that embrace radical ideologies or express their support to an existing extremist organization can push an individual to indulge in such activities. Religious institutions promoting extremist ideologies are major major factors that shape ideologies of these individuals. Role of media, especially, which makes it easy for individuals to get radicalized these days, unlike earlier times when physical sermons and religious gatherings or religious scriptures played a major role. Several terrorist organizations like the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda have been actively using the social media platforms to mobilize their ideology and inspire individuals to wage lone wolf attacks. Now, getting into lone wolf terrorism in Israel, majorly two major reasons that have increased the incidences of lone wolf terrorism in Israel, one being the Palestinian nationalism, the anti-Zionist ideologies through inspiration through non-state actors such as Lebanese Hezbollah, Hamas, and Islamic Jihad has been one major cause, and by the Kahanist ideology that has been instilled in Israelis, where the extremist Jewish nationalism prevails over, where the ideology that says that Israel is only for the Jews has also led individuals to wage lone wolf attacks on the target population. A study in 2018 on 700 attackers were conducted to chart the profile of lone wolf terrorists using personal factors, influence of ideology, psychology, and trigger events. The results are as follows. The average age, like we see, is 22 years, and 28% of men and 11% of women were impacted by ideology. Two-thirds suffered from psychological disorders. 54% preferred to die in the attack, and high tendencies of familial problems among female attackers, as well as 60% posted message of intent on social media before the attack. So going on to counterterrorism strategies that Israel has been using successfully, it's been utilizing technology, intelligence, and operational adjustments to potentially nab lone wolf terrorists. First is the anti-terrorism fence to prevent infiltration of individuals into into the territory of Israel, like we see in the picture, there are multiple layers which make it almost impossible for individuals to penetrate into the territory to execute their attacks. Second and major one is the cyber technology. They're using something called predictive intelligence, which uses social media data and which uses algorithm to analyze social media patterns and conversations of individuals and checks any trace of violent intent. After, with human intelligence scrutiny and through military forces, sting operations happen to capture these individuals. But there are human rights concerns which say that even if you arrest an innocent, this might probably encourage people to create radical ideology which was not present in the first place, which will be counterproductive for the state. Other passive retaliation methods have also been used by taking away their work permits or producing significant economic losses to the attackers' families and arresting religious leaders. Cooperative mechanisms among the intelligence and security agencies like Mossad and Israeli Defense Forces have also worked out really well for Israel. They also take the help of bystanders to collect information. Moving on to lone wolf terrorism and its implications for South Asia. Like we've seen, traditionally, organized terrorism has been part of South Asia. Lone wolf terrorism has slowly been increasing. For instance, in 2019, Indian Defense Minister Rajnath Singh acknowledged lone wolf terror attacks as a major security threat for India, and he stressed on the need to be prepared and updated with the tactics. Reports suggest that Al-Qaeda in the Indian subcontinent has pursued the publication of contents online to motivate individuals to launch lone wolf strikes on India. The same concerns are going on and among Bangladeshi experts, where now the militants have changed their tactics to follow the ISIS model of lone wolf terrorism. The police officers have been the primary targets, and they've been using knives and IEDs and low-grade ammunition to cause small-scale attacks. Even in Sri Lanka, after the Easter 2019 bombings, concerns on lone wolf attacks have been rising. So South Asia, being a very geographically clustered region, terrorism, its penetration is very easy to achieve with online contents, especially that incite violence and the optimum use of cyberspace by terrorist organizations. Things have been made even more possible where vulnerable individuals can easily fall prey to such influences. A Singapore-based think tank says much possibility prevails in South Asia of lone wolf carrying out such plots inspired by larger terrorist groups. So concluding, lone wolf terrorism evolving nature needs to be comprehensively studied to absolutely differentiate it with other lone actor phenomena. Several root causes include personal and socio-political cultural factors. And as we've seen, counter-terrorism strategies enforced by Israeli government has been quite successful, and they rely rampantly on both technology and human intelligence. Especially cyber security has been pretty successful, and South Asian states can, despite the difference in geopolitical situations, they can still think about using cyber technology actively to monitor such proliferation of radical issues in South Asia. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Poornima. That was a very, I would say, comprehensive understanding of not only the phenomena of the lone wolf, but as well as, you know, the very needed comparison with the other phenomena, the way it's playing out in the rest of the world, and the lessons that we can seek, etc. So you. I'm sure more questions coming your way. And with this, we come to the last presentation of today's session, which is going to be done by Ms. Priyanshi Chauhan. Welcome, Priyanshi. Priyanshi is also pursuing her PhD from JNU, and she is going to be talking about something very new, which is that she is going to be talking about electricity trade in South Asia, which is going beyond the bilateral interconnections. So again, she's going to be focusing on the very multilateral interconnectedness of the region as a whole. And I welcome you. Please start.
Thank you, Chair. Can we have the slides, please? Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My presentation is on electricity electricity trade in South Asia. I will be discussing this in the context of rising demand for electricity in the region and examine the rationale for electricity trade by studying the key trends. Can we move on to the next slide, please? Then I will discuss the initiatives for energy cooperation in the region and the geographical here will be limited to Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, and Nepal because the existing electricity interconnection is between these countries only. Moving on to the next slide, we see that in the last decade, the countries in the region have experienced an increasing demand for electricity. Can we move on to the next slide, please? Okay, so here we see that over the last decade, countries in the region have experienced an increasing demand for electricity. So it is because of their sustained economic growth and also the need to facilitate economic development. Now, as Ms. Swati in this panel was talking about sustainable development goals, electricity access also has a huge positive spillover effect on achieving many of the SDGs, like access to clean energy, climate change mitigation, and gender equality, and other indicators as well. So electricity demand is bound to increase in the future too. There's a mismatch in the demand and supply of electricity, as can be seen in table one, and this has been the trend for over the last 10 years, where the demand is outgrowing the supply of electricity. Moving on to the next slide, we see that data on electricity access highlights. Can we move on to the next slide, please? Yes. So data here highlights that in Nepal, 93% of the population has access to electricity. In India, 95% of the population has access to electricity. And in Bangladesh, it is 85% of the population. Now, moving on to the next slide, we see that despite this high access to electricity, the electricity
disconnected. Sorry, we got disconnected. We'll join again.
Thank you so much. So despite this high access to electricity, as we saw in the previous slide, the electric power consumption per capita is very low in South Asia as compared to the world average. In addition, there is an excessive reliance on unclean fuels in these countries. Therefore, the region as a whole has a shared challenge to meet the rising demand of electricity in a secure, affordable, and sustainable manner. Now, one way to effectively address this is through trade in electricity. Next slide, please. So the country-wise patterns in the use of energy resources is highlighted in this slide that shows single source dependence in the electricity production. As can be seen here, Bangladesh majorly relies on natural gas, which is 76% of its energy mix. In India, the coal dominates, which is 60% of its energy mix. Similarly, hydropower has a maximum share in the energy mix of Bhutan and Nepal. Now, interestingly, when we see this from a regional perspective, this shows that there is a diversity and complementarity in the resource endowment in the region, which allows for pooling of resources to optimize the energy use. Now, simultaneously, there are complementarities in the country-wise electricity demand patterns as well, due to intra-seasonal and peak time differences and different load curves. Now, this whole diversity and complementarity, one in resource endowment and second in demand patterns, offer opportunity for electricity trade in South Asia. In the next slide, we will see the region initiatives that have been undertaken based on these complementarities. The most significant one here is the 2014 SAARC Framework Agreement. However, it needs to be emphasized that this framework agreement is only a set of guiding principles to promote regional electricity cooperation. It is only at the initial stages of conceptualization of the idea of power integration in South Asia. It is marked by a complete lack of a future. future plan for the development of a regional power market and its process for its evolution. In the next slide, you see that electricity trade exists between India, Nepal, India, Bhutan, and recently in 2013, it started between India and Bangladesh also. The trends in the bilateral cross-border electricity trade highlight that India majorly exports electricity to Nepal and Bangladesh, while it simultaneously imports electricity from Bhutan. It should be again emphasized here that the electricity trade in South Asia exists only bilaterally and not in a regional framework as of yet. It is only bilateral and government to government. There is an absence of the regional level institutions to monitor, implement, and review the development of regional power market in South Asia. Next slide, please. Also, there is no evidence yet of trade between countries with third-party access to the transmission grid of another country, meaning the trade process here is entirely bilateral and government to government. No evidence yet of third-party access. However, in 2018, the Government of India announced the new guidelines for the import and export of cross-border electricity to facilitate regional power trading arrangement by allowing Bangladesh, Nepal, and Bhutan to sign tripartite agreement for electricity trade and provide for transmission corridor on the Indian territory. Now, the guidelines, therefore, are an enabler to regional electricity trading arrangements in South Asia for the future. Moving on to the next slide, we will see that there are a lot of challenges that this electricity trade or energy cooperation in the region faces, both at the regional level and domestic level. Now, there have been instances where projects have been cancelled. Most evident was in the case of Myanmar, Bangladesh, and India pipeline, where the project was to transfer natural gas from Myanmar to India via Bangladesh. Now, this MBI pipeline was to benefit India in meeting its energy demands through the gas exports from Myanmar. It was to benefit Bangladesh by allowing it to earn huge foreign exchange in transit fees. And it also had a clause that allowed for use of gas imports by Bangladesh in the event of depletion of its own indigenous gas reserves. Now, despite these benefits, the agreement did not continue. In 2005, Bangladesh imposed three conditions for the project to continue. First, it asked for a custom-free land corridor connecting it with Bhutan and Nepal via India. Second, it asked for a customs-free passage for hydroelectricity transmission lines from Nepal and Bhutan. And third, it wanted India to take the onus of correcting Bangladesh's high trade deficit with India. Now, India did not accept any of the three preconditions and the project did not continue. Now, what does this show? This shows that despite the economic viability and feasibility of the project, it was the political mistrust, the strategic and security concerns in the region that determined the success of an economically beneficial project. Also, the question of trade deficit that was raised by Bangladesh also highlights that the trade imbalances in the region have contributed to the feelings of deprivation of access to the Indian market from the neighboring countries, which is likely to disrupt regional integration on account of lack of mutual benefits. Then there are unresolved border issues and the increasing involvement of China in the region that have also been irritants in the regional cooperation lately. Moving on to the next slide, I present a different set of challenges which are based on the power sector reform. Now, the power sector in South Asian countries is not liberalized yet and it continues to have a significant state regulation. The monopoly market structures and regulated tariff setting do not offer adequate incentives to invest, and it makes it difficult for the existing power utilities to recover costs, and it affects their ability to invest in the cross-border infrastructure that is needed for regional electricity trade. Then other than this, there are differences in standards across the selected countries for technical, regulatory, and policy framework. The issues around transmission and infrastructural needs and investment for bilateral electricity trade, they are addressed at the national level or they're agreed upon in the bilateral power purchase agreement. So there is an absence of regional level institutions to monitor, implement, and review the development of regional power market in South Asia. Next slide, please. Despite these challenges, South Asia should continue discussions about regional electricity. I recommend a gradual approach to regional integration, which should be followed moving from bilateral electricity trade as it exists today to third-party access, and finally, a multiplayer regional competitive market, as has also been done in the case of GMS. Further, regions should develop a comprehensive policy framework that goes beyond the existing guiding principles as in the 2014 SAARC framework agreement, and it should have detailed provisions for implementing and monitoring, harmonization of transmission codes and operating system and dispute settlement. And lastly, the regional and domestic challenges should be addressed simultaneously to promote regional trade and elections. Thank you.
Thank you so much, you know, for your presentation, Priyanshi. And with this, we come to the end of our session today. A very informative session we've had on various themes, very various intersectional, interconnected themes running across South Asia, which were not really limited to a particular country. And in a way, which also shows the very complexity of the region of South Asia. So I present my congratulations to each one of the presenters. And we have a lot of questions, actually. So I would be, I think the better way is that I send about a couple of questions to, each one of you, and then, you can answer. So the first question that I have is for Sindhu, which is, Sindhu, are you there? Yeah. So Sindhu, the question to you is that, this question is being asked by Afla, and Afla is a journalist with a Hong Kong-based news agency, and he wants to ask you a question, which is that how these asymmetric conflicts affect the economy integration of South Asia. So he wants to know that, so the fact that there are asymmetric conflicts, how does this affect the economic integration that goes on in South Asia? So what are your views on that? Thank you. The other question, I'll ask one more question, and then you can answer. The other question is to Purnima. Purnima, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Purnima. So the question asked to you is by Bharat, Mr. Bharat Kumar, and the question he's asking is that can you please name any other extremist ideology except Islamic ideology shaping the lone wolf terrorism of attackers? So he's interested in knowing that do the lone wolf attackers have any other adherence to ideology except the Islamic ideology? That is one question to you. And you have a second question also. So the second question to you is asked by Afla again. As I said, he's a journalist with a Hong Kong-based news agency. His question is that, don't you think that instead of directly labeling media, we can say that the IT sector has helped more in propagating ideologies as the root cause of the lone wolf terrorism? So what are your views on that? I'm giving you a time to think of your response, because after this, there is a question to Priyanshi. And Priyanshi, your question is asked by Deepak. And if you are there, please note your question, which is that despite having traditional electricity transition systems between India and Pakistan, what are the major hurdles that you see between these two countries in terms of electricity trade, besides having SAARC regional electricity agreement and commitment toward regional electricity cooperation? So these are the questions. So maybe you can answer these one by one. We can start with Sindhu and then come to Purnima and then come to Priyanshi. Meanwhile, if there are other questions, I will again ask you those questions. Please go ahead, Sindhu.
Thank you. Thank you for the question.
Yes.
I think how the economy gets affected is, one is that the investments are affected, be it foreign direct investments or between the two countries themselves. There is threat to the infrastructure assets of the countries. So that's another economic implication. And another being the, I think tourism gets affected because people would be unwilling to travel to these countries and of the economic effects. And also, I think when asymmetric conflicts in the region increase, it also becomes a premise for major powers to intervene in the regional politics, which could affect the
right.
state of the region. And
right.
there are some effects that we see. Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Poonima, would you like to take the stage? Yes.
The first question concerning other ideologies. As mentioned in the presentation, one of the major causes of loanwolf terrorism in Israel itself is the Kahanist ideology. It's a very extreme Jewish ideology, which is not very conducive to people of especially Arabs and Palestinians to... It's against their demand and claim on Israeli territory. And so Kahanist ideology is one. And second is white supremacism itself. That has also been very much shaping people's ideology, especially the rearing of radical ideologies in individuals that encourage them to get into lone wolf activities. And the second question is about media and IT. I stress especially on media, it's because media is much more of an attractive medium to convey a message, like print media as well as online media, through images and videos and various attractive messages. You can capture the individuals, especially who are very vulnerable, easily than... So that's the only reason I mentioned media specifically, but definitely I would agree that IT has enabled this phenomena drastically. Thank you.
So have you answered both your questions?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, all right. So the other set of questions that I have right now in front of me, Priyanshi, I think you also had a question. Please, Deepak had asked a question.
Thank you, Deepak, for the question.
Could you be a little louder? Could you please be a little louder if possible?
Between India and Pakistan, it has always been the bilateral relations. You know, even if we have better relations, they are momentary. So the future is always anticipatory. And there are huge sunk costs involved in setting up the entire electricity trading arrangements. So, you know, with the anticipatory relationship, the economic benefits, they might be feasible, but the future is very hazy. So because of this anticipation in the relation, that is one of the reasons. And second, I would say when you interconnect grids, you also kind of trade off your security, because energy security in that sense, you can always interrupt the entire country's energy grid. So India and Pakistan, the kind of relations, the political tensions that they have, they do not want to give each other another weapon to be used in future. Are some of the constraints that we have in India-Pakistan, despite having a huge cultural endowment and colonial level pre-independence transmission infrastructure. These are some of the reasons why the interconnections are not happening, or the trade is not happening between the two countries.
Thank you, Priyanshi. With this, we can move to the other set of questions. So the question that I have is for Babita. Babita, if you're there. The question which is asked to you is that despite the stringent laws on dowry, why dowry demands and debts are still so prevalent in our society? So there is a penal code, you know, in most countries with respect to dowry, and still the demands are going up and the debts are going up. So why do you think it is like that? Babita, are you there? Babita, are you there? Am I audible? Okay, meanwhile, I think Babita is not around. Maybe we can ask a question, to others. So, for example, I would want to ask, and I think I received some questions about it, which is that, talking about the first presentation, Ambika. So, Ambika, if you're there, so I wanted to ask you something. So, you discussed the major, two rivers, the Indus and Ganges, and you said that it is a very vulnerable region, etc. And the measures here have to do more with the stepping out, of that bilateral, obsession. So, I want to know your views on is that very recently, I think there was a news that, Pakistan is thinking of constructing a dam which India is. What I want to know is that when these kind of issues get faced with, say, hostile neighbors, so what should be the way to go about it? what do you think should be a global mechanism or a regional mechanism to go about, you know, these kind of issues when faced between hostile neighbors? Because South Asia, unfortunately, is home to just so many conflicts. So what are your views on that?
So, thanks, Dr. Rao. That's a very good question. And it's a very difficult question also in many ways. So I'll just take us out of South Asia for a second. You're absolutely right in saying that this region is full of conflict. So it seems like a lot of these things are harder. But look at some of the other examples from other parts of the world. And so we say like West Africa, for example, or Southern Africa, Latin America. There are many countries that have come out of hostile relationships. They don't have very strong diplomatic relationships. They don't have what we would consider in IR a state of warm peace, right? They are in states of cold peace, so to speak, but they still cooperate on certain aspects, shared rivers, shared lakes being one of them. So the underlying theory that we can't cooperate with our hostile neighbors or with a neighbor that we're in a state of cold peace with on this subject doesn't always hold. This is, we've seen it in Central Asia also, for example. However, India and Pakistan have a very special kind of relationship that has sort of defied all sorts of theory and all sorts of logic that we've seen across the world. And I reiterate again, one is by increasing our understanding of what's happening on either side through both our academic and think tank community. The other is really to increase this multilateral relationship because while we have the Indus Water Treaty and that's held from 1960, it's not a treaty that reflects the realities of today. So one, we need to really look at how we can increase and improve that treaty, you know, add amendments and annexures to it. This is not going to happen just by with India and Pakistan coming together. It needs two or three other parties to come together. So if we were to have robust multilateral institutions in this region, it creates a space of dialogue.
Right.
It creates a space of dialogue where you can talk about why the electricity isn't working, for example. It creates a space where you can talk about how you can improve your climate change reactions in the future. It then creates a space of dialogue. So you build these little blocks of trust in areas that are not as contentious and then maybe bring in water that is a much more contentious issue. I'll give you one small example. We have a lot of problems with China. Some of them have been exacerbated in the last couple of months, but
right.
Our relationship with China is tenuous at best. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not so good. But we still do a lot of work with China on research on the glaciers, for example. And that's an area we've said, okay, we're going to do our work together on this. Everything else we can figure out as well on the side, right? So it is possible for these things to happen. So in that sense, the multilateral institutions play a very helpful and positive role.
Right. Thank you so much, Ambika. I have two more questions. So we'll take both the questions together.
Okay.
One is for Swati and the other one is for Karnika. So please could you listen to your questions and then respond. So the question for Swati is that so you mentioned about climate change and you mentioned how climate change and how it's happening in South Asia, and you said that it has to be understood as a historical responsibility and you have to develop you know, there has to be a certain development of partnership, etc. And then you said that you mentioned European, the context. You said that, you know, you come from a European background and then you were interested in looking at it. So the question that I want to ask you is that, and you can take your time to respond because I'll have another question, directed to Karnika and then both of you can respond later. So the question is that, what I want to know is that to what extent do you think that issues like climate change, which are obviously selling like hotcakes, you know, they tend to be reduced to merely vote bank politics, okay? And not really fetch the kind of results that they intend to fetch. And do you think that on a deeper level, the sense of awareness is something which is still lacking. And, you know, it just sounds like a very interesting, fashionable catchphrase. And so everybody is talking about it, but not a lot is being done on the ground. So do you think that this whole thing of vote bank, how that kind of, you know, comes into play? Is that in thing that I wanted to know from you. And the question which is there for Karnika is that she was talking about Karnika. So Karnika was talking about youth radicalization in South Asia. And you said that one way is that, you know, the youth radicalization is also happening because there is a history. There could be a history of, you know, those people being, you know, sexually, so to say, assaulted or unemployed and all of that. So, which is making a lot of sense. What I would want to ask you then is that, are you research which is available on such matters? Because generally we tend to be very focusing on our respective subjects. So when you're talking about youth radicalization, and if you're looking at it from from a area studies background, you would not really venture too much into, say, the nitty-gritties of, you know, the psychology and the social costs, etc. So obviously you are still doing your research, but the question is that are you really happy with the kind of work which you are getting for reference? And does it not then indicate a kind of a responsibility that is there on academia to, you know, to kind of, you know, just to mitigate these disciplinary, so to say, boundaries that we have created, and we want to, if we really want to have a better insight. So these are the two questions. So we could start with Swati, and then we can go to Karnika. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Rao, for your question. I think you very aptly said that a lot still needs to be done, and a lot has been said on policy, on paper, as far as policy making is concerned, but the results are not there to be seen. And I mentioned that my presentation. In fact, Guardian came out with a news report a few months back, maybe last year, that climate change has become this buzzword, you know, this entire bunch of catchwords that has been very lightly used by many people these days. And unfortunately, few of these people, or I don't know, common people living, don't understand what climate change exactly is. So I guess the answer that I feel, you know, lies in the fact that we need to spread awareness right from the beginning, right from from the grassroots level, and spreading awareness among the youth about climate change. And if mass movements by taken up by common citizens can bring about a change, or can, you know, these mass movements can force the government to take action to, you know, bring about, do some constructive policies or constructive implementation of those policies at the ground. These subnational agencies or these movements, in fact, they hold the potential to a large extent. And this is not just in the case of India, even in the case of European Commission. The European Commission comes out with a number of reports every year, a number of policy briefs, but they are all 20, 30, 40 page documents, very bureaucratic, very, you know, language that you might not be able to understand in the first place. Right. But even right from there, I feel even these reports, if they are deconstructed for common citizens like us, not talking about the European citizens, but in the entire, you know, crossing across boundaries. If these reports are, made simpler for people to understand, then I guess the policy towards climate change can be implemented in a more efficient manner. And it has to start from the classroom level. That's the way. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Thank you for it. So we have more questions pouring in once again. So the question is one, I have a question for Purnima, and then there's a question to Karnika again. So both of you can take your questions. Meanwhile, I'm sorry, I think Swati answered, but Karnika, would you like to first answer my question or take up the question that just come again? Would you like to take both the questions together? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. You want to answer the first question of mine. All right. So you can take the first question, and then after this, we have another set of two questions. So yeah, please go ahead.
You were referring about academic think tanks and academia.
Yes, yes.
As I mentioned earlier, also, there's a lot of need to have collaboration with civil society, mm-hmm. academia for community engagement, but still there are think tanks who are doing tremendous, which are doing tremendous work. For example, BITS in Bangladesh, BART in Nepal, and National Institute of Security Studies in Sri Lanka, which are collaborating very frequently to counter the radicalization and terrorist policy. So we cannot say that academia is not doing anything, but yeah, there's a lot of things which needs to be done and which needs to be pondered upon more easily and more regressively. Like I believe in that, that it needs to be done more frequently instead of having gaps and instead of only having discussions and rather than being it implementation and being execution. There's a problem in execution and implementation, I think. There's a lot of talk about discussions, but when it comes to implementation and executing these policies, South Asia as a region faces the problem.
Right, okay. All right. Thank you so much. So we have, two more questions. So one is for Purnima. Purnima, if you're there, you can take the question, which is that Mr. Bharat wants to know, can you please give some idea on Hindu extremism and Hindu ideology in shaping societies? So he wants to know about that particular strand within the Hindu ideology that can fuel, an extremist, so to say, version of the religion. So that's what he wants to know. And the other question is to Karnika, and this question is being asked to you by Afla, which is that what, according to you, are the reasons for youth radicalization by some state agencies, is what Afla wants to know. So please, could you now go ahead with the answers?
Can I start?
Yes. Yes, please.
So firstly, I wanted to make it clear that terrorism has no religion. These are just misconstrued ideologies that are put in a very attractive way to lure individuals into such extremist activities. And with respect to Hindu extremism, with whatever limited knowledge that I hold, Hindu extremists have not showed tendency towards acting as a lone person. It's generally organized political extremist activities that at least India has seen. I am not sure if I will be able to comment on the effect of Hindu ideology in shaping societies. This is what I think I will.
All right, thank you. Thank you. And Karnika, so you also have a question. Would you want to go ahead with it? Yes.
That radical groups in South Asia especially does not exist in vacuum. There is always support of state sponsors. There's state sponsored. Every political party uses their political agenda. But as a region, if we look at South Asia, the states are very weak and no step is sufficient in countering radicalization. As a society, what we need to do is that radicalization is a long process of conversation and having a dialogue between people. So what we need to have that we are, as a society, we are religion and faith-based, and we cannot separate religion from politics. But what we can bring is to increase tolerance power within people and can bring rationality in the religion so that people are more rational in their ideology. So that's why we can do that.
All right. Okay. Thank you. So if we have no other questions, then I would like to close the session with my remarks. So, as you all know, first of all, let me just thank every one of you to be so patient and hang around, for the till the very end of the session. This was, I think, a very mentally riveting session, because we tended to put all the papers together, which were to do with the region of South Asia. And South Asia is pretty much in news, as all of us know. And wonderful papers were presented in this session. And all these papers even individually speaking, I think they tell us that they are going to be big projects very soon. And most of the participants here are pursuing their PhDs. So I hope to see very good work coming out, from each one of you in coming years. If I may be allowed to, conclude, with my understanding of this entire session, or just wrapping up, I think in my opinion, one thing that we need to know as the vantage point is that all these presentations, what was that common thing that all these presentations talked about? Which is that, you know, South Asia is just that often we tend to see South Asia as a concrete reality, you know, I mean, if I'm just trying to kind of theorize it for each one of you out there. Because obviously we are all inheritors of a particular colonial strategy, okay, a particular colonial legacy, which is that we tend to look at South Asia more in cartographic terms, okay, in terms of where the lines are drawn by our colonial masters. And we thought, or the Britishers thought, you know, that just by drawing lines, you know, so you are bringing into, you know, existence the new states, and they are going to be functioning as proper modern nation states. But what kept being hidden was that it was still an unfinished project, because, you know, nations are not drawn on papers. Nations are drawn on, you know, several other important, deep-rooted, you know, characteristics. So what I would want to then sort of leave you with, which is a thought also, and quite an interesting one at that, is that South Asia, whenever we look at South Asia, we need to remember is that it is a kind of a unfinished, lost project of modernity. Okay, because what we need to know is that the intellectual and the cultural terrain of this region is much more thicker than what meets the eye, which is that, you know, if we constantly, South Asia is home to so many international conflicts. South Asia is known, right now, South Asia is home to, I think, the worst border disputes in the world. You know, look at what is happening, you know, with our border in China or Pakistan, etc. Okay, Bangladesh, you know, so many problems. So what we need to then remember is that we cannot look at South Asia. If we want to solve these problems, okay, we cannot keep looking at South Asia in a thin understanding of this nation here and that line drawn there, etc. We have to somewhere grasp the embeddedness, the thick cultural embeddedness, okay, like so many of these presentations talked about, that we all share a kind of a shared solidarity for mass movements, for civil disobedience. You know, one of the presentations talked about how this entire thing of climate change is coming up as a civil disobedience. So civil disobedience, if you go into the details of it, is a shared form of resistance to the colonial rule in a way. So what I'm saying is that we then need to kind of revisit, okay, we need to revisit. And since here, most of the people or the presentations and audiences are familiar with international politics and the international relations theory, My point would be that, you know, we are in a great space because we all know the constructivist theory of international relations, where the meanings and the concepts are not fixed in time. They're not fixated at time, but they keep evolving because we need to make sense of the world as we inherit. So that is something which is quite important. Heuristically, I think the understanding that South Asia is still an unfinished project of modernity gives us a kind of a heuristic tool to then have a better insight into all these problems. And one common thing that I'm sure all of you must be seeing there is that none of these problems is located within a particular country or within a particular nation, you know, for that matter. Okay, they're all transboundary, transnational, interconnected, problems which need the same kind of responses. Okay, and that be generated as long as we are obsessing about the conflictual nature, the cartographic nature of our region. So with this, I leave you at that. And once again, thank you, the Nepal International Institute for organizing such a wonderful, summit. And thank you so much to all the presenters and to all the participants for their patience and their interest. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Swastika. We now come to the end of the first session. We'd like to express our gratitude and sincere thanks to Dr. Rao for joining us today and moderating the session. Thank you also to all the paper presenters for sharing their valuable expertise and to dear participants who contributed with their questions for taking the discussion forward. Please do join us at our next session. So once again, thanks to all.